So that's what we're, the climate of our business 5 years from now, that's what we're going to do.
Let's come on.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Fáilte, Raibh Gachtain and Seo. I want to welcome you all to our first online conversation here. And I extend a welcome to everybody joining us over the internet. And I hope that you will listen to and learn something from the discussion that we're going to have here this morning. It's an issue that I think is important, and it's one that I'd like to everybody get engaged in because it's so important for our country. So the conversation we're going to have today is focused actually on how the internet can provide the means for Irish companies to continue to do business, to improve business, and of course the consequence of that is to reach new customers at home and abroad, the impact being that this will drive demand for products and for services, increase sales, obviously increase profits, and at the end of the day create more jobs, which is what the essential focus of government is about here. So I want you to understand out there that we're very fortunate to have with us today leaders from 10 firms who will share their experiences about what opportunities getting online offers to companies, what getting online has meant to their companies to date, and the sort of obstacles and difficulties that they've had in actually making the progress to the point where they are now. So I hope that by broadcasting this conversation, we will also encourage many other firms to take, if you like, the online plunge. You see, governments can only do so much. And the really important here is peer-to-peer involvement and engagement and experience, because it's from that that others take courage, others learn lessons, and others can develop. So your time is precious, and I want this discussion to be as productive as possible. Let me say that you represent a good cross-section of Irish business, large and small, long-established and newer firms, trading online, and some yet to do so, a good regional spread, and some trading in goods and others trading in services. Let me just say a few remarks in general about why we're doing this. Firms who serve their local communities are really important. I met the Small Firms Association yesterday. There are 1,800 companies a month being set up. There's a great interest out there in promoting ourselves, getting out of the programme we're in, and getting on with creating jobs and prosperity. So I just want to say that you actually deserve enormous credit for what you have achieved and what you continue to achieve in what has been a very difficult time for our country as one of a number of countries. So one way, of course, to deal with lesser footfall going through places is to be able to have new markets, and that means being able to trade online. It can help you to win back local customers, reach new ones. Ireland's in the middle of an online revolution. Research tells us that 3.7 billion euro is spent online every year by Irish customers. That's a lot of money, a lot of customers, a lot of jobs. And the average Irish shopper now spends 116 euro online every month, average. So the potential is obvious before we consider what it is that we can do. Research also shows us that 3/4 of the potential custom and spend goes abroad. A lot of stuff coming in as well. So the simple fact that if business doesn't involve itself in this new revolution, you know, you potentially lose customers, you lose sales, you lose revenues, and as a consequence, jobs get lost. So we want to make an impact about that, and that's why you're here today. I've said this before. I want by 2016 to see that this country is the best small country in the world in which to do business. And my interest and the government's interest is about one job, 10 jobs, 100 jobs, or 1,000 jobs, because it's in there that the potential to restore our position actually is, and this online revolution is part of that. So I want to hear from each of you your own experiences. What has it meant for you? Is it a good thing to have online sales? Is it a good thing to be able to have this capacity? How is it going to impact on the high street? Obviously, planning decisions over the years have meant that many towns suffer because of lack of footfall in town centres. What's the impact for you? What's been your experience? How's it going to impact for the future? So some of you are are well established here, and some sectors are better than others, obviously, in the online business, travel, accommodation, electronic goods sectors have all been transformed by online sales. Other sectors have quite a long way to go. So Minister Rabbit, who supports this fully, is dealing with the government's national digital strategy, obviously, which has the capacity to bring speeds and communications to everybody. We aim to get 10,000 businesses online for the first time. And we have an action plan for jobs, which is supervised by Minister Richard Bruton and also from the Department of the Taoiseach to make it effective. And that's really about listening to people like you and saying, look, here's a problem, here's an obstacle. We don't have endless pits of money to throw at these things. So it's a case of being pragmatic, being effective, and easing the way for business actually to do jobs. And we have this trading online voucher scheme, which allows for €2,500 to be paid directly to people who want to get into the business of retail selling. And that's going to apply to 2,000 firms across the country. Obviously, we're setting up a forum, which is like this, if you like, which will involve key industry personnel, the ICT, banking, digital content sector. They'll explore how industry can assist and be assisted in this area. And that's one of the key areas in the sort of trading online in the sort of trading online business. As I said, we also have the assistance of a number of people from major industry, and I'd like to welcome Sean O'Driscoll, who's here beside me, who is the chairman of Glen Dimplex, a very successful company indeed, and Ronan Harris, who's the vice president of the large customer sales section in Google, who's here representing John Hurley, who has been of great assistance to us over the past period. So we've got 10 firms here. We have David Flynn from Happy Pear, Joan Gordon from Vibes and Scribes, David Doyle from Doyle's Butchers, Jackie Rinn from Fresh Thinking, Gordon Newman from Lifestyle Sports, Michael Crean from Mixed Garage, Bernard Hill from Gutterman.ie, Karen White from the White House, Will Mullen from Wine Online, and Gordon Stewart from Adverts.ie. So, I want to hear from you, your experiences firsthand, to learn from this, listen, and where appropriate to act. So, I'm going to start this first online conversation here in Retail Online by asking David Flynn to say a few words. Thank you, David.
So, just to give you a bit of background about our company, myself and my twin brother started the Happy Pear 9 years ago. We started as a fruit and veg shop right in the High Street in Greystones. We quickly moved into a juice bar, a whole food cafe and restaurant. And today we've got a superfood farm where we grow sprouts and wheatgrass. We've got we're involved in a cherry farm and a fruit farm, and we've also opened up a second premises. We've been online for the last 2 years. Our first online venture was to do our own retail shop, so selling fruits, vegetables and health foods. And then the other part was the sprout farm. The wheatgrass farm also has an online shop. So they're both separate just due to the logistics, it would be better if there was one of them. And then our third online business is happyheartcourse.com. So it's an online health education course. So heart disease accounts for, 40 or 50% of deaths in Ireland and worldwide. So we've been doing health education courses upstairs in our restaurant for the last 5 years. So I'll just give you a quick background about it. So we came up with this course focused on heart disease. We got nurses in to measure people's cholesterol, blood pressure, and heart disease, or blood pressure and weight on the first night. We put them on a whole food plant-based diet for 4 weeks. They come in once a week and we teach them how to cook. We give them meal plans, recipes, and then they come back after 4 weeks, or they come once a week and the nurses come back after 4 weeks and measure all their stats again. And it's been hugely successful. We've had hundreds of people through the course with an average drop of cholesterol of 20%, so just by changing people's diet. So we there's lots of media attention about it, and people from all over the country called up asking, hey, I want to do this course, but I can't get to Greystones. How can I do it? So we saw a huge opportunity, and we built an online course. We thought it would take us 2 weeks. It ended up taking us 2 years. We shot 50 video recipes. We shot tons of videos, learned about how to put education online. And it's been online for a year now. It's a huge opportunity because, in one sense, it's a golden goose in that it's got, the whole world is your market, whereas our other online businesses are only for Ireland. So to date, it's been a huge learning curve. And we assumed that as soon as we built this product, it would be an overnight success. But we subsequently realized that selling it is even more of an art than creating a product. So
how many do you reach throughout the entire three sectors that you have there, David?
With our online business, we only employ about 3 people. With our whole business, we employ about 50 people.
About 50, yeah.
Yeah. But most of our Happy Heart course sales have been in Ireland. We've sold 2 in the States, 1 in Canada, and 1 in Holland. So we're international trading.
You know where you want to be in 3-5 years' time.
We see massive opportunities in it. So, yeah, there's so many opportunities. It's just getting investment and figuring out exactly where we want to go. So we've looked at teaming up with people in the States, and we're going on a road trip at the end of the year.
We'll be back to you, David. Yeah. No, Jackie.
Right, thank you. I'm Jackie from Fresh Thinking, and the reason why Fresh Thinking was set up as a website was to provide an advertising platform for online training to interact with your clients. Should I start again or just? I'm the business development person in Fresh Thinking, and it was set up by Catherine Fitzsimons because she was made redundant from her position, and jobs were scarce at the time. So hence she decided to call it Fresh Thinking. And the business was set up to provide training and coaching services to SMEs and corporates. And we've also began to develop personal development training, which includes mindfulness and stress management, which we feel is very relevant in today's stringent times. Catherine went online with a very tight budget. She had €1,000, and she had to make a decision. Do I put this in print adverts to try and fill courses, or do I set up a website? So she decided she would set up a website to maximize her resources and generate an interest. And it would also give her a permanent presence online rather than just calling up newspapers and asking to place column ads. So myself and Catherine met at a networking event. And we decided we would form an alliance because we're 2 sole traders, and it's impossible to do everything yourself as a sole trader. So rather than being competitors, we said let's collaborate our ideas, our skills, our resources, our knowledge, and our years of different types of expertise. I had come from a self-employed background, and Catherine had come from an employed background. So we complemented each other. Catherine set up the website, but when she set up the website, what she realized is it's not just about setting up a website. You need to also engage in social media. So she's an early adapter to social media, and she enjoys that end of it, which is very important if you are online. The benefits that Fresh Thinking has gained and online is that it's raised attention about the business. But it's not just from the website, it's also from social media resources by using Twitter, setting up business hubs. Catherine helps gain attention for herself, but while she does that, she also tries to help others get attention online too. If she had used the resources, the money that she had when she started the business and the website, the €1,000 would not have reached the people that she has reached today. It wouldn't have given her as much access to customers, and people wouldn't have known about Fresh Thinking. So for Catherine and Fresh Thinking, the benefits have reduced the advertising costs, and currently we don't sell online. We haven't started to do that yet. When I heard David talk about what he's the online courses, yes, that's what it is. We know that's what we need to do, but it's the time to actually put into it. So it's having that time to set up the online courses. So that's basically a little bit about Fresh Thinking.
Thanks, Jackie. I've got a couple of questions that in the general discussion, we'll come back on that. Now, the agri sector, as you know, is one that's increased in importance in Ireland over the years. We're now exporting over 9 billion in terms of food and drink. And there's been a really strong return to prominence of Irish butchers, where the standards are very high and the creativity in a whole range of things is very new and very good for people. And David Doyle is here from Doyle's Butchers, and you might give us a couple of reflections on what you're at, David.
Thank you, Taoiseach. Yeah, my name's David Doyle from Doyle's the Butchers, and we're a Wicklow-based company, similar to the Happy Pear. But my father and grandfather are butchers, and just changing with the times from changing to online trading. But we started off initially with an abattoir in Bray, and we supplied Roach's Store supermarkets along Leinster with beef, lamb, pork. And since then, we've changed away from the wholesale end into retail. We opened up for our first retail shop back in 2009 in Frascati Shopping Centre in Blackrock. And since then, we've opened shops in Kilcool, Bray, Clare Hall, and Kildare Town. And we're opening a new shop, the sixth shop in Dundrum in the village centre in October. And it's not just a butchery shop, it's going to have a fish counter, wine, full deli, fresh fruit and veg, and a bakery section as well. So we're constantly changing to adapt to the market to satisfy the customers. Because I find that we're just selling meat on its own, people come in and they're looking for something to go with it. So if I don't change, I'll be left behind. So we are constantly thinking of what has to be changed so we can keep the ball rolling. We started trading online back in 2010, and it was quite a success. There was many reasons why it was a success. The likes of with the retail shops, we had overheads that we couldn't do anything about. The minute we opened the shutters in the morning, we had rent, we had rates, we had service charge, we had insurance. When we sell online, the product is the same quality as in the shops, but we don't have these overheads that we would have on a main street, on a high street. So that's one benefit that we would see from selling online. The other thing with when we're in convenience shopping centres, when you sell online, you build up a long-term relationship like the shopping centres with customers, and you notice that people, it's the same customers and the same delivery addresses that people are buying meat online. As I said, we started selling online in 2010, it was meat only, and through Retail Excellence Ireland, we decided to change web designers and to, instead of just selling meat online, we want to sell food online and work in line with this new shop in Dundrum, which is opening in October. So we're currently in the process of upgrading the website to have not just meat products, but to have fresh fruit and veg and fish, all fresh food products online as well. My experience is fresh meat. So we are working with local producers to sell product online, where people might say, well, I'm only selling fish, I don't want to go online, I plan on bringing the whole thing together. So people have a full solution for food as opposed to just meat or wine or
And David,
bread.
Are most of your customers in the region, or are exporting anything abroad?
Not abroad, no. Not abroad.
So you've got to have a delivery service then set up as well.
The main deliveries when we were trading online with the e-commerce was the Midlands, to be honest with you, a lot of Midlands based. Mm-hmm. But it was all, we found we would have new customers on a weekly basis, but it was a lot of repeat customers. And they'd even phone you to find out, do you stock another product or so, but they still wanted to buy online. The main challenges, as I said, regarding with the high street, there's overheads that you can't cut back on if you want to trade. But the main drawbacks with it is just regarding the e-commerce end of it, regarding finance fees. Like our company, we have 5 locations, 6 before the year's out. We employ 30 people. It doesn't make financial sense for me to have a person in the office just solely dedicated to managing the website. So I have to split that task between the person doing another task. And that's where I find I'd like to give the website more attention and service, and mm-hmm. I don't like half doing anything. So that's the reason why when a company, an SME, it's hard to, I can't just throw money at it and just, because it's not there to throw at. And then secondly, regarding if I was a big multinational, finance fees regarding like online transactions, there's an overhead per year regardless if I sell 1 transaction online or 1,000 transactions online. And it's about trying to, when I split that between my orders, obviously if I doubled the amount of sales online, that cost would be 50% less. But it's about trying to move with the times. As I said, we started with the abattoir, then we moved into retail, and now we're moving to online. But just trying to, I find when you're an SME, you move slower than if you had all the resources available to you. And I feel we have used the job bridge scheme, and that has assisted quite a lot with moving things on where we find it's been, we're not paying for the full amount of the employment, the payroll, and it's assisting us to progress onwards.
Thanks for that, David. Obviously advantages, but a number of challenges in there as well. Now we're going to go down to Gordon Stewart here from Adverts.ie. Gordon is the Group Finance and the Operations Director. Thanks.
Taoiseach, firstly, thanks for the opportunity of being here today. Adverts.ie is owned by Distilled Media Limited, and Distilled operates some of the biggest and best known websites in the country, including Daft.ie, Boards.ie, TheJournal.ie. Adverts.ie is an online marketplace. It was spun out as a standalone site in 2010. Since that date, we've got 500,000 registered members. And last month alone, they listed 160,000 items for sale. In terms of values of transactions going through the site, we estimate we sold about 17 million euros worth of goods through the site, and since starting, almost a quarter of a billion euros worth. There's three main areas to Adverts.ie. There's the private members business, which is basically members of the public selling amongst themselves. It's free to list an ad on Adverts, and you only pay for premium features, so ad upgrades, that sort of things. We also have a recruitment section on Adverts.ie, and we've got 1,300 jobs up there at the moment, specialising in retail and catering sectors in particular. And also Adverts Shops, which is probably most relevant here today, was launched 2 years ago. Our aim in launching Adverts Shops was to give small offline shops an easy way to get an internet presence by really lowering the barriers to entry in terms of no technical skills required, instant access to a heavily trafficked website, and no fees to list items, only a small commission if you sell an item, so there's zero risk. We also cater for existing online retailers and hopefully expose them to new business and new opportunities with our membership. Today we've got 1,300 small retailers selling through Adverts Shops, and together they list 35,000 items online at the moment. The challenges that Adverts faced as a purely online business are probably challenges that a lot of online companies will face, or a lot of retailers going online. We group them into three main areas. There's financial challenges, as you mentioned, the difficulties in processing credit card payments online, notwithstanding the fact that Adverts is owned by a profitable and successful group. It took us 18 months to secure a merchant ID in order to take credit card payments online. The cost of compliance is creeping up. There seems to be a lot of regulation coming down from Europe and from government. It's turning into a big burden for SMEs. Looking at the last 2 years, whilst broadly all of the regulation and compliance that has come down has been very worthwhile, we felt that in places maybe the consultation process has been lacking. The implementation has been overly restrictive or overly prescriptive. And some new legislation has muddied the waters for us rather than clarifying matters. And the third main element is recruitment. Despite the current economic climate, I'm sure everyone here knows that it's very difficult to get experienced, skilled staff. We have a graduate recruitment program for technical or for developers, which is working well, but unfortunately, 7 out of our last 8 experienced technical hires have travelled from outside Ireland to take up positions with Distilled Media. In fact, we're now advertising on European recruitment websites in order to try and attract talent to fill our jobs here. There are some other issues that we believe are barriers to online trade, specifically the lack of postcodes, which I know is being addressed, the postal system, broadband infrastructure and mobile phone coverage, as well as a general lack of knowledge on how to get online. We have some suggestions on what government could maybe do to address some of these matters, so maybe we can come back to
that in the roundtable discussion. Yeah. I'm sure your experience is actually able to help somebody like David here in the challenges that you identified in yours. Now we'll go down to Gordon Newman here in Lifestyle Sports. Gordon is the head of e-commerce in Lifestyle. Gordon.
Thank you for inviting us today. Lifestyle Sports launched its online store in October of last year, and we've been trading online now for 12 months. And leading up to actually opening our online store, we reviewed not only the competitive landscape in Ireland, but also the competitive landscape from the UK, because there's a vast number of our UK competitors shipping into Ireland. And the stats have already shown that three quarters of Ireland's online spend is currently shipped in from other territories. So as a result, when we were looking to build our online store, we needed to build an online store that would be able to compete with other retailers from the UK. And that meant that we needed to spend about 12 months going through a technology selection process, a recruitment process, and then reconfiguring our entire business to be able to support an online business in a way that was credible for our customers. So what that actually means is that everybody and every function within our business needed to get behind the launch of our online store. Everybody from buying, merchandising, technology, security, marketing, our visual merchandising team, finance, everybody was involved in the launch of the online store. It was really important for us that it wasn't launched as a silo and that it didn't sit outside the rest of our business. What that then has subsequently meant for our online customers is that they now are integrated with our high street business. We have 65 high street stores nationwide, and our customers can choose to click and collect. They can order from their mobile. They now have choice, and they now have choice in the same way that customers in other territories may have. So if you order from us, for example, in the afternoon, your order will be delivered to one of our stores the next day for you to collect. Over a quarter of our customers now currently choose to have their order delivered to one of our high street stores. And when they get there, they have the opportunity to try the garments on, to try the footwear on. If it doesn't fit, they have the opportunity to return, they have the opportunity to exchange and engage with our store environment. So we've really focused on trying to build a multi-channel experience for our customers, rather than just try and build an online store that sits outside the rest of our business. And that's been quite successful for us, but it's not been without its challenges. We've found that recruitment has been a challenge, and building skills has been a challenge. Building skills within our own team and our own people, particularly around operating and managing an e-commerce business. So it's not just a technical skills gap, it's also a management gap that we've found. We've also found that everybody in the organisation, as I've said, has an important role to play. If the organisation isn't fully behind and fully supportive of a move to online, then that move will fail. We've been very fortunate in that we've managed to maintain that momentum. One other point that we've found particularly challenging is a lack of ancillary suppliers and technical services that we can buy in from Ireland, and in some cases we've needed to look offshore to be able to buy those technical services in, and particularly around marketing and support. So that definite skills gap is something that we find quite frustrating and quite restrictive. Postcodes would also be a huge advantage to a business like ours for a number of reasons. It would help with our distribution efficiency. It would help with fraud management and fraud protection. And that's another area where we've been challenged in that there is no shared fraud information. So there are data protection challenges around this, but there is no shared fraud database that retailers can look at, and that's present in other more active markets. And if we had access to that, we could then offer a greater range of payment options. We could relax some of the protection mechanisms that we currently have that restrict some of the business that comes around through our online store. Our biggest challenge now is going to be building our export business, and that means that we're going to go into the UK market. But the UK market, whilst it is the most active market for e-commerce globally, the spend per capita is higher than anywhere else. It's also the most competitive. So we will need to plan this incredibly carefully. We'll need a great deal of support to do this, but there will be expense in terms of infrastructure, in terms of fulfillment capability, because we want to deliver the same level of service that we're delivering for our companies, our customers in Ireland, to customers abroad.
Thanks, Gordon. Number of interesting observations there, particularly on the fraud database. I'm going over to Will Mullen here from Wine Online, and Will is the Business Development Manager.
Thanks, Taoiseach. WineOnline.ie is a family business. We were set up by my mother and a business partner as a limited company in 99, so 14 years ago now. We were the first online trading wine company at the time. And for the last 14 years, we've largely ran the same website. We import from small producers all over the world, so largely Europe, Spain, Italy, France, and further abroad, Chile, Australia. And we now list about 800 to 900 wines on our website. So we've, over that time, we've built quite a database of wines, but also through the years, quite a lot of loyalty and quite a lot of a big database that we've been able to lucky to retain through the years. The main crux of our business is a gift market business. So our customers would be predominantly Irish people, expats abroad, who've moved away. That, I suppose, gives us maybe in some ways a new market for business potentially as well. And we would have a lot of Irish people who would, throughout those years, have bought wines for themselves, that would know our wines and know our products and things, and buy directly from us. We're lucky in that, in some ways, being an online business, we have no retail premises and never have. It's always been online since the day we were opened, so we don't have the overheads that are associated with retail that some of the other guys are talking about. Bizarrely, we've come in a slightly different route this morning. I only heard that we got approval to have a retail premise coming towards Christmas, so for 5 or 6 Saturdays on the way into Christmas, we'll be able to open a retail. We have a warehouse in our premises in Santry where we're based, so we'll actually be able to open that to the public. That will allow people, I suppose, one of the problems we've had in the past is that people, while we've got a huge database of wine, we can't necessarily get that to people to taste, to try, before they can buy, I suppose, effectively. And wine is such a personal thing that people want to be able to do that. So that's a good development from our side. I say gift market is our number one business, a huge area for growth for us over the next couple of years as more and more spend from Irish consumers are spending online and buying for themselves. There's a huge potential for growth for us, we think, for delivery of wine directly to households throughout Ireland. And that's one of the areas that we're concentrating on. We were part of the Activating Dublin programme over the last couple of months with Google, Facebook, PayPal, the Dublin Chamber of Commerce, and that's really given us a lease of life to be able to engage with all these other companies, like all of us that are here today, to hear and share all of the various different problems and challenges that we're all up against together. So throughout that programme, we broke down a lot of the barriers with the help of the big multinationals, Google and Facebook and PayPal, about being able to really access the simple information that we really need to get our businesses going. We are about to launch a new website in the next 5 weeks, and when I joined the business in about 18 months ago, naively I initially thought that we might be able to update our website and all of our platforms in maybe 3-4 months, and it's taken this long for us to understand, to learn about the amount of information that's out there that we need to access and get. Really, I mean, I've spent the last 12, 13, 14 months just trying to access and get that right information and put it into a great, great product and a great website for us to go forward for the next 15 years. And we've done that now, and we're hopefully at the point where we're ready to launch in 5 weeks' time, and we're really, really excited. We've new branding, we're really looking at updating everything we do, as I say, to carry us through the next 15 years. In terms of being online, I just mentioned our model is cost effective because we don't have a retail premises. Our operating costs are minimised naturally enough because we don't have the high street stores that a lot of these other businesses have. Direct marketing for us is something that is inexpensive because we would have a big database, and we're lucky that we've built that up over the last 14 years. So we find being able to engage directly with our customers is quite good like that, those people who already buy from us. There are issues certainly in marketing a new website maybe, but we're fortunate that through some of the platforms like Google AdWords and other things, we can we we know that they work for us, and so that and direct marketing means our marketing budget isn't all that expensive as it might be if we were just one high street store in one location. And naturally enough then, as an online business who are trying to target both Irish people all across the island and abroad, the online gives us access to all of those people worldwide, again as opposed to where we just one local store in one town. So online, from that point of view, for a business like ours, is really, really a great opportunity and a great chance for us to.
I'll come back to you, Will, about some of the some of your experiences in respect of setting up your website. Did you have the same
absolutely
problems that Gordon's identified here about over bureaucracy in some areas? Construction sector is something that's so important to the economy in general. This used to deliver over 25-26% of GDP in very different times. It's now down to 6%, which is too low, so we have to get this moving because it's an essential part of the development of our economy and jobs. And Bernard Hill is in charge of gutterman.ie, which is a part of this, and I'd like to hear some of your story, Bernard, please.
Thanks, Hector. Well, I started in this business in 1999-2000 when I retired from the military, and I bought a couple of vans and I marked them as the family business was called R&B Guttering, and I discovered that after a while, advertising locally through leaflets and stuff like that, you just got a local market and there wasn't that much business, so I just needed the get it out there to the whole city of Dublin at least and the outskirts. So I just needed to go online to do that and to find a word that said what we've done and where to find us. And there was a Batman advertisement on. So I done a radio ad called Gutter, 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 Gutter Man. And that started me going. So I thought that was it. Signed all the trucks, gutterman.ie. So as a drove by, people would see it, they'd remember it, and I'd get a phone call. That's where it started from. So I worked on the website then. I'd done a web design course myself, done my own HTML website, just one page, nothing fancy, and things started to work. And then I decided that I'd do a video, a YouTube video, to explain, you know, what we've done, because people would ask the questions and you'd learn from your customers what the questions they ask. So I've done a few YouTube videos, put them up on the website, and then I found when I went to a customer's house, they thought they knew you, they recognised you, you know, and they said, where did I see you before? No. It was just the videos. So then I got a few professionally done videos then and moved on. And I'd have to say, without the web, anybody in the construction business would be very quiet. But it's not quiet for us. We're quite busy, thank God, and I hope it stays that way. But it's only because, well, you work hard at it, obviously, but the web opens all this up to you. And even coming in this morning, I was talking to a guy that does these bouncy castle things, and he was asking how's business. He says, terrible, terrible. And I said, do you advertise? He says, yeah, I got leaflets. Are you on the web? No, I must go on the web. I heard Google is very dear, though. And I said, look, the web is the cheapest form of advertising known to man. So he got me address. I'll do him a website. And he'll be up and running in a few weeks himself. Hopefully that'll be all right. And then I got a phone call from a guy there last week. And he needed a repair done. I doubt his house done a repair. He was a foreign man, just in the country a few months, bought a house. And he said to me, thank you very much for being on the web. You know, because he knew nobody else. He needed this done, but didn't know who to ask. He went online, found gutterman.ie. And it was just a nice feeling to get that from a foreign man in the country, you know. It was a pleasure, you know, to do that. I have to say, without being online, I'd be unemployed.
Bernard, you made two interesting points. That first of all, that you learn from the customers, and secondly, your YouTube gave a familiarity to the person when you went to actually talk about whatever the job was. Thanks for that. Now, Karen White is from the White House. This is the WHYTE. Karen's based in Westport in County Mayo. I'd like to hear something that you have to tell us, Karen.
Thank you, Taoiseach. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Karen White, and I'm in the extremely fortunate position of living and running my own business in the White House in Westport, voted best town of Ireland in which to live in. And it is, believe me. The White House is a fashion emporium, and we specialise in top-to-toe quality occasion wear and day wear for the over 30s. While we do have strong local support, being a tourist destination, a lot of our customers are visiting from outside the local area, and they regularly return, including visitors from the UK and further afield. Part of our the White House appeal, apart from offering Irish and European designer fashion, is that we provide a highly personal level of service to each and every customer that comes through our door. And as a result, the vast majority of our clients are repeat businesses, and they refer us to other people, i.e. mothers of the bride, groom, people going to christenings, things like that. So we wanted to go online, but translating this personal service into an online present is quite a challenge. My first attempt at this process was 7 years ago, when I had a website designed and built externally. But the problem was that I found that I lacked the skills personally to maintain it, and it very quickly fell into disuse and became extremely impersonal, which was the very opposite to what we strive for in our company. It was a frustrating and expensive experience, but I did learn a hell of a lot from it. However, customers increasingly visiting the shop were suggesting that we should go fully online, as knowing what we do and who we were, they'd love to browse our product range from the comfort of their own sofas, whether they be in Dublin, Galway, London, New York, and they would support us. Also, with the downturn, I also came to realise that some of our loyal clients no longer had the disposable income that they had previously. Our overheads were rising, our margins were falling, and our access to credit was severely restricted. So going online offered us the possibility of increasing sales and accessing new customers. Earlier this year, I read an article in the paper and became aware of a program called the Clicktailing Experience, which was run from the Digital Hub. It advertised itself as the boldest retail stroke e-tail experiment of 2013. It promised to transform traditional bricks and mortar businesses into retail businesses, into online retail destinations from start to launch within 5 weeks. Now, having had an e-presence before, I thought this is absolutely impossible, but hell, I'll go for it. I was fortunate enough to be accepted into the program, which was run by Mark Kearns and Fiona Highland from the Digital Hub here in Dublin. The Clicktailing program gave us access and training from designers, developers, stylists, photographers, logistics providers, online marketing tools, and payment processors, all the skills that are required to run a successful online business. For 5 weeks, 20 businesses from around the country who had very limited technical expertise but great determination were brought into a room together, and by God, did we put in a hell of 5 weeks. But we all survived and came home with brand new websites, smiles on our faces, and full of trepidation as it dawned on us over the 5 weeks what we were letting ourselves in for, that online presence is like a baby. Once it's there, it has to be nurtured and you can't give it back. So my first order online came from Singapore, and I was so surprised and shocked. I thought it was a joke and phoned the people who gave the training program to ask them, were they testing me out? But they weren't. It was a real order. So it then dawned on me that this is reality. I can now, if I choose, promote my business internationally. And while the country is struggling to get on its feet again, perhaps internationally is where we should be focusing on. While it's still early days for the whitehouse.ie, it has given me great hope that we can grow the business online over the coming years. I'm currently in the process of hiring an intern through JobBridge to maintain and develop the site for me, as it takes a vast amount of time to do it and a hell of a lot of input from other people. If this proves successful, I will definitely be employing that person full-time and hopefully creating more employment in the years to come. I would highly recommend that people try to get involved with a program like Clicktailing, because it is fantastic, it gives you confidence, it allows you to learn things you never thought were possible, and it makes you focused on what is coming to us all in the future. Without clicktailing and also without an online presence, our business wouldn't be here in a few years' time.
Thanks, Karen. I note that you were able to avail of what's in the Digital Hub, which is a very exciting place.
Yes.
That you were able to get a quality person from the JobReach scheme. But I also note that your customers are repeat customers,
yes.
Therefore you've built a sense of trust with them.
Mm-hmm.
That they know if they do business with you as one retailer, that it's a quality experience that they get. That's important.
Yes.
Now we'll go to Joan Lucy here from Vibes and Scribes. Joan.
Thank you, Taoiseach, for inviting me. I'm a shopkeeper for over 20 years, and over the 20 years I've noticed a lot of change in retail, and you just have to go with the change. We've diversified a lot over the years. We originally started in the book business, and we're still fairly strong in the book business, but that has been challenged. So about 5 or 6 years ago, we diversified, first of all, into arts and crafts, then we added on wool, and then fabric and haberdashery. And just over a year ago now, I decided to streamline all the haberdashery arts and crafts business into one premises. And so we rearranged the businesses and we allocated our Lavitz Key businesses to our new bookstore and second-hand bookstore, and then we amalgamated all the non-book businesses together. So looking at it, we did have good interaction with customers because we have knitting groups and free lectures and that, but we needed to do more. So I decided I'd buy myself an iPad and an iPhone and just try and get into the mindset of my new customers that I was hoping to receive. So I suppose at that time I heard a radio program where Dublin Chamber of Commerce were talking about doing a pilot scheme with Google, Facebook and PayPal, and it just seemed just what I needed. So we applied and we were accepted. So myself and two of my staff came to Dublin. Now Brian, who had ran our Facebook for us, had some technical experience, and Fiona, who's my buyer and manager, and she's just marvellous at everything. The two of them came along with me, and it just was a fantastic experience. It opened the door for us. We were like three people who knew nothing about the online from the business point of view. Once we arrived, we learned so much. First of all, they had set up, which was very, very helpful for us, a Facebook where when you came back and you had any problem, you just put your problem on Facebook and the group interacted with each other and supported each other. Then you met other people. We met Gordon from Lifetime Sports and we were able to talk with him. And he gave me one really, really good bit of advice. While Fiona and Brian were concentrating on the technical side of things, he said to me, get your stock in order. And that was something then that I could really focus on. That was what I went home and focused on then. So between that, our next thing, I suppose, was we were looking at how to set up. And the first problem we came to was the developers. I felt there's a huge divide between developers and retailers. Maybe it's because we're a small business. I employ 15 people. It just seemed, when we contacted the retailers, the first question was, what's your budget? Now, as a shopkeeper, if somebody asked me, what am I going to spend on? How much am I willing to spend on something I don't even know what I'm getting? It just wasn't on. I just couldn't. And then we also found, we got, and I know they probably didn't mean this, but they gave us long lectures on what they felt we should do. And we found it very difficult to get them to listen to what we needed. Like, I describe our business as slightly old-fashioned in a way, because a lot of the products, you can't put barcodes on them, even though we have a lot of products. So with the support of the group, the Dublin Chamber of Commerce group, we set up our own online business ourselves. We have, over the last, since April, all the staff gathered together, and one of the things that really did, it really got great sort of camaraderie amongst the staff, everybody working together. I discovered talents amongst my staff I never knew they had. In fact, I'd say I'm not even sure they knew they had these talents. We were people who became very good technically, great photographers, you know, just everybody rallied around together. And we have now completed, today we're launching our online shop. We have inputted 5,500, well, it could be 600 by now. I was talking to them this morning. I don't know how fast they're going today. But, and now we have made mistakes, definitely. There's no doubt about it. And we had to go back and make corrections. But we're very pleased with what we've produced. And I suppose our next challenge now is to promote it properly. But I suppose we had to make the judgment of make sure that we picked the right products that would be saleable online. It would be fine to put on books, but you couldn't compete with Amazon. So we chose carefully, and we also felt from our customers as well, we had a lot of visits from people from all over Ireland, and they would say, I wish I had a shop like this in Galway or in Dublin or in Wicklow. And so that prompted us also. So, and we have gathered over the time as well, a database of newsletter people that we send out newsletters. So we're giving ourselves about another week just for the initial problems to start to settle down, and we'll send out our newsletter then to people. And we've also created within the website a database of crafters. So if somebody is making their knitting and they want to sell their knitting, or they're making hats or shoes or whatever, that's a service we'll also offer them. And also we're supporting our customers by putting on a crafter's projects, so they can go in and see how to do, learn from the website as well. And so we're just, I can't really say what will happen from here, but I'm very optimistic. And also I have employed two extra people.
Well, the very best of luck with that, Joan. Might I say there's certainly nothing wrong with having a business that is slightly old-fashioned. People have a great grow for these things as well. And I'm very glad that you took the advice of Gordon, get your stock in order.
It really
and wouldn't. That you've actually pointed out something, that the staff that you employ have talents and capacity that you never even knew about until this whole new adventure has started for you. And I'm happy to note that Dublin Chamber, who have been leading in so many fields, had a programme that was exactly what you needed.
Fantastic.
And that you learned from that, no more than Karen did when she did her programme as well. Now, one of the people who spoke to me some time ago about the potential of online sales was following a request that I had to go out and open a facility for Mixed Garage in Park West of Dublin here. And I have to say I was fascinated by what I saw with a young, vibrant company in the way that they could reach out to literally hundreds of thousands and millions of people from their own initiative. Because Michael Crane and his brother were both unemployed a number of years ago, and his story is one of success, where you put all these things together and achieve, build on your dreams and employ people, provide a quality service. So Mick, give us your reflections.
Yep. Taoiseach, thank you very much for having me here. As Taoiseach mentioned, MixedGarage.com is an e-commerce company, a multi-channel e-tailer selling car parts and accessories worldwide. The business was started in 2004 by myself and my brother Kieran at a time, as the Taoiseach said, when I was unemployed. The initial idea of the business wasn't to set up a business. The initial idea was to actually learn how to set up an e-commerce system so I could get back into employment. So that was the real aim. So literally I bought one book and went through the book from start to finish, and that's where our business started. So while I was unemployed, I worked harder than any other time in my life, 12 hours a day, because I really got into it and enjoyed it. We had our first order in 3 months later, which was incredible. And even though I'm not a web designer, more of a developer at the time, realized, there's absolutely massive potential here. So we initially ran the business from cash flow, but that allowed me to get back into full-time employment, went back into full-time employment, but part-time we're working on the business. Slowly but surely, orders were coming in. We didn't do any advertising at all at the time. It was just SEO was being picked up, and sales slowly but surely started to trickle in. We went, hold on a second, we have something here. So just to give you a couple of milestones, we took on our first full-time employee two years later. That was in 2006. We launched in the UK in 2008. Just last year, we did a large funding round. We went out to the markets to get money to help develop the business a bit further and quicker. So we did a large funding round for $2.5 million between DBIC, NCB, and some private investors. We launched our eBay Australia store in May. We are launching our German website, mixedgarage.de, in November this year. So just to give you an idea of a bit of revenue, this year we're on target to hit €7 million in revenue. We're growing 60% year on year. We currently do 15,000 orders per month. And just to give an idea of the markets we're in, last month we sold to 35 countries worldwide. 60% of all our sales are now export, but that should grow to probably 90% just because of sheer scale, should grow to 90% over the next year or so. The UK is our main market, but we're actually getting orders from as far afield as Australia, the Middle East, pretty much every country in the world we're getting orders from at the moment. In terms of employment, this year we have grown from 21 people to 44 people. By the back end of 2015, we will have over 100 people. The purpose of the website was just to sell more products and engage with customers in a more meaningful way. And it's not just as simple as putting up a website and customers will come. It takes a lot of hard work. And really, I mean, you know, we talk about here, the retail have advantages over online in lots of ways because you can go into a retail shop, you can actually touch the products, you can feel the products, okay? So we had to try and come up with systems whereby we can almost give them that experience. So you're looking at technology to produce 360-degree images, technology for videos. We produce with a video team that's constantly non-stop just producing videos on how to do different things because it's the closest you can get people to touching and feeling the product. In terms of experiences, I mean, it's certainly very rewarding to be able to sell to people thousands of miles away. You're no longer sitting in your shop waiting for customers to come. What you're doing is you're putting yourself in front of customers and when at the very time that they're looking for a specific product that you have to sell. Okay. Because we didn't have a bricks and mortar business, we started from scratch with no cash at all. It was quite difficult at the time setting up with suppliers because we didn't have any traction. But we got a couple of suppliers that actually bought in on it, and we initially started off as a drop shipping company, so we didn't have any stock, anything. So literally suppliers would ship out the products for us. Now that in Ireland, drop shipping is well underdeveloped at the moment, but it is actually growing. So there are opportunities there, and I think e-commerce is unique in that regard, in that you don't need sometimes a huge amount of cash to get a business up and running. Again, in terms of the breadth of products we do, we looked at a lot of systems out there and websites and different things, and we said, well, this is not much good. Really, we do need to build our own. So what I had developed when I was unemployed, we decided just to build on that and constantly maintain that system. And that's a really big advantage to us at the moment, because even huge changes, if our competitors in the UK or around Europe make a very big change, it might have taken them months to do it. We will literally go and we can make that change in a week. So we can turn around very big changes in our systems very, very quickly. But if I could give any advice, I mean, to people, one of the big things for us was to actually get out there and talk to companies who are in the same boat as yourselves, who are trying to get on board, or are in the e-commerce field, or just trying to get in there. People are very, very good with their time, and companies are very happy to help. So if you know any e-commerce company, just pick up the phone, ask them, can I get in there? Can I come and talk to you? For us, that was the one big thing that really opened our eyes in terms of the opportunity, because sometimes when you're sitting in your shop, you think, how far can I really go with this? Go and visit some e-commerce companies and talk to them, and you'll see how far you can go.
Mick, thanks for that. And I know from first-hand experience of seeing what you do out there, how you have adapted technology to give the customer the opportunity to kind of see and practically, literally feel the product by 360-degree imaging and all that, which is very innovative. Now, the action plan for jobs set out by the government had a whole range of things that government felt it could do to ease the opportunity for business. Some have been reflected here today, and I'm glad to see that people have identified where there are a number of obstacles, and we can always follow through with that. But one of the things that we did do was to ask really thriving, successful businesses to assist in the work of government in driving forward objectives. We called some of these objectives disruptive reforms, fancy name if you like, to make pretty radical changes. One of those changes was to get 2,000 extra businesses online this year, and we had offers of assistance from many companies, same as you say with the e-commerce people. But Sean O'Driscoll here is the chairman of Glen Dimplex, which is a hugely successful company employing thousands of people worldwide that have done a remarkable job. And Ronan Harris here is the vice president of the large customers sales for Europe, the Middle East and Africa in Google. And they're two of the companies that came on board to assist in pointing out to government how successful companies have breached these barriers and how we might put in place, you know, opportunities for businesses just like yours. So I'm going to ask Sean to say a few words, ask a couple of questions, and then Ronan. Then we'll have a bit of a discussion about some of the issues that you've raised.
Thank you, Taoiseach. Could I just say to the 10 of you that I've just heard, this has been an inspirational last hour. And I think what you've demonstrated is the art of the possible. And you're clearly people who believe in change. And the internet has changed the way we will communicate. It's changed it for all times. Online retailing has changed the way we do business and has changed it for all times. And it comes back to that word change. And people, by their very nature, are reluctant to change. They're uncomfortable with change. But the world is all about change. And it's been ever thus, this perpetual change. Your business, my business, is changing while we've been sitting here for the last hour. And that's what it's about. And I believe change comes about for three reasons. It's the consequence of three circumstances. One is a crisis. And boy, do we know that in Ireland. We've had to change everything we've done as a consequence of the crisis that we've had. The second one is, it comes around from catalyst for change. And I've just heard 10 of you who were catalysts for change. You're rewriting the rules of tomorrow. And that's what it's all about. And the third one is disruptive reforms, which the Taoiseach has touched upon. And shortly after the Taoiseach taking up office, I met with him and he said to me, what are the issues? And I said, Taoiseach, firstly, nobody would listen. And secondly, inertia. And the Taoiseach said, I will listen. And Taoiseach, you have listened. And I'm in absolutely no doubt in my mind, our economy has turned the corner. If I look at our business, and if I go back 10 years ago, a lot of our customers were saying, nobody will ever buy a fridge or a gas cooker off the internet. They'll want to go and feel it and touch it in a shop. Well, they were wrong. And if I roll on 5 years, 5 years ago, our third largest customer in the UK was what was historically an iconic electrical retail brand called Comet. They had 500 stores, 7,000 employees, 2 billion in turnover. It doesn't exist today. It went out of business last year. Many of you have heard and seen Woolworths. Every high street in the UK, in many of our cities in Ireland, doesn't exist today. That's the way of the world. If we don't change, and if we don't write the rules of change, not only will we fossilize, we will die. Some of the biggest employers in this country historically were gatekeepers at railway crossings. They don't exist today. Bank tellers and bank branches. They don't exist today. Telephone exchange operators and telephone exchanges. They don't exist today because the world keeps changing. I then turn on to one of our largest customers today, one of our top 20 customers in the UK. It's a company called Appliance Online, and I'd encourage you to go and look at their website. That business was started Christmas 6 years ago over a £5 bet between two friends, one who always said he could set up an online retailer. His friend, who was a software writer, said you couldn't, and they'd a bet of £5. That business today turns over 400 million, set up by a guy called John Roberts. It has its own television studios in Manchester to run its own audiovisuals, where they run audiovisuals and products explaining every feature in the product. And their customers no longer need to go into a bricks and mortar store to feel and touch a fridge or a gas cooker. And marketing is key to their business. It's not selling, it's marketing. It's explaining the features of the product and why you should buy that product. And it's a different type of marketing. And John Roberts, like you, has proved the art of the possible. Today, 40% of all small domestic appliances sold in the UK are sold online. And as Gordon said, UK is probably the most advanced when it comes to e-commerce. Again, one of our customers have two different businesses within their overall group. One is a departmental store that sells clothing and also sells furnishing. The other part of it is a grocery chain. So if you click and buy clothing in one of their divisions, or furnishings, home furnishings in their division, you can collect it in the grocery store. And what has their grocery division discovered? For every person who comes in to collect a product, they spend an incremental £50 in groceries in their stores. That is cross-selling, cross-fertilisation. We see the whole benefit of online in our business from the point of view of online communities. And again, I would encourage you to go and visit our Morphy Richards website. Morphy Richards has its own online communities where people, you know, at the end of their day, are online talking about our products. And it is a huge source of free marketing information for us and feedback on features of our products that the consumer likes, or indeed features that maybe we can improve upon. Again, incremental benefits. We talked about the issue around the cost of online retailing, but look at the full cost of doing business. One of the big costs in our business is brochures, and as soon as we have them produced, they're dated, because we're constantly bringing out new products. Instruction booklets. And what do we all do with instruction booklets? We throw it out with the packaging. So we've put them all online, and we can keep them up to date all the time. So we're saving huge costs in that part of our business, and then reinvesting it in other areas of our business. Michael and Karen talked about exports. And I think there is a huge opportunity for Ireland in this space, but I think we need to go about it differently, Taoiseach. Delighted to hear Karen talking about her first sale was to Singapore. I was in the Northern Ireland of Hokkaido 3 years ago. And at the end of a meeting, a Japanese lady came to me, and she was wearing a beautiful scarf. And she showed me the label on the scarf, and it was Avoca. And I said, so you've been to Ireland? And she said, oh, no, I bought it online. That is the power of the online opportunity. And Taoiseach, I think maybe we should look at a Brand Ireland website in the export area. And to try and minimise costs for the businesses we're talking about here today and their equivalents out there, maybe an Enterprise Ireland should put up a host website, put the infrastructure in place, do the building blocks, and then individual people who are hosted on that website, what they do is they just structure the website based on the original platform that's there. But I think there's a big, big opportunity if, you know, if we get this together. Very interesting what Michael said about cash flow. Selling online, you get paid up front. You get when you buy in product into your stock, you get credit from your suppliers. The whole working capital of a business can be transformed as a result of this. In some cases, you don't need working capital. You probably have, you will have a positive cash flow because you're getting paid before you have to pay your suppliers. So again, there's a huge opportunity, you know, for businesses when they go online. Absolutely agree with the comment that was made about stock. It's not just about a website. It's about, you can't sell something unless you have it in stock. And that's the same whether you're online or bricks and mortar. But the second part of it is logistics. You know, if you commit to having something there within 48 hours, it should be there in 48 hours. So in conclusion, I would say, you know, the 10 of you have demonstrated to all of us, reach out to tomorrow, embrace it, write the rules of tomorrow, be relevant to tomorrow's customers, because you can sell to yesterday's customers.
Thanks for that, Sean, and I'm quite sure that the initiative you've mentioned there about having Enterprise Ireland, for instance, host a website would allow for a reduction in costs for many of the smaller outlets like we have here today. This would be of enormous advantage to them in terms of
setting up the initial cost structure. Now, I was down in Google on a number of occasions, and if you haven't been down there in Barrow Street, you should visit the place, because there's an energy and an excitement about it with all of the young people who are working down there in so many divisions around the world that you leave the place, you know, filled with enthusiasm and excitement about meeting the challenges in a world which is changing at bewildering speed in this whole area. And Ronan Harris is one of those who knows all about this. And his boss, John O'Hurley, has been, you know, a constant advocate for no fear of change here in this area. So, Ronan, you might reflect on what you've heard and give us some of the benefit of your advice as Sean O'Driscoll has done here.
Sure. Thank you, Taoiseach. Thanks for the invitation to come today. Well, I think the excitement that you witnessed down in Barrow Street is probably second only to the energy that you get from companies like this, who I find truly inspirational. You know, we've got companies which are all shapes and sizes. Some of them are local companies, some of them are national, and even the ones that used to be local or used to be national are now finding themselves going international because of the power of the web. And I think this is a story that you're going to hear more and more. And it's certainly one that I witness every day. You know, if you come back to your opening remarks, and you were talking about the Irish consumer who has gone online with huge enthusiasm over the last number of years, and even today I think Ireland has the seventh fastest growth in online usage globally. So that journey continues for the Irish consumer, and it is something that's been harnessed by these businesses. They've recognised it in the comments from the customers coming in and out of their shops. They're now responding to that by developing their web presence. And, you know, going online can be a daunting thing, whether you've got the expertise or whether you don't. Taking those first steps to create a new division or a new aspect to your business is difficult. But when you do, you start to find that it opens up, first of all, a whole new channel of conversation with your existing customers. It opens up a way for you to connect with them in a much more personal way, as Gutterman has, where he's now recognised when he walks down the street. So it gives you a great personal contact with them, but opens up a whole new market of export. I think the other thing, it's not just growth in these businesses that you're hearing about, but these businesses who are now going online are starting to employ more people. You know, Joan, who's just launching her website today, a traditional business, it's been around for a long time, but already she's growing her team in order to embrace the opportunity that online brings. And I think this is a great opportunity for Ireland over the next few years. If we can continue to grow the use of digital by our existing businesses, there's an opportunity to grow that to 6% of GDP by 2016. That would create 18,000 jobs. Just by the growth of existing businesses embracing digital. And it's a trend that we see all across Europe. Businesses who embrace the power of online to connect with existing or new consumers, they're growing their businesses at twice the rate, they're creating new employment at twice the rate, and they're exporting at twice the rate of their competitors, which I think is really exciting. It's definitely where Ireland needs to be right now. And that was one of the motivations for us under the Activating Dublin umbrella with Dublin Chamber and Dublin City Council to come together with Facebook and with PayPal and put together the Activating Dublin initiative, where we've taken 20 companies as a pilot program through this journey. And we've helped understand their challenges, helped figure out what's helping them get online, what's getting in their way of getting online. And we're now writing up that playbook, which we're going to share with your team, Taoiseach, in the Department of Communications and Department of Jobs, so that they can apply those learnings in the initiative around the voucher scheme.
Thanks, Roland. My first engagement with Google, they set a target of having 10,000 extra people online, and I was down there to greet the 10,000th person on time and on target. I think it was a plumber from Dundalk or County Louth. And the consequence of his going online was, well, like Bernard said, it meant so much in terms of future business and setting it out. And if you follow that with the competence and trust, these people talk about it and business comes back. Now, you've got two real experts here from two outstanding firms. I like to think that what I heard here is a demonstration of conviction and belief and people following their dream. Can I ask you, Gordon, because you mentioned a number of issues where there is undue bureaucracy. From the political perspective, some of these things are very complex and very technical, cyberspace and all of that. I invite you, when the meeting is over, to submit to us the examples of where you see bureaucracy that perhaps, you know, that, the departments and the ministers involved here might be able to relieve that sort of bureaucracy if it's creeping or building.
Perfect. We also have two submissions, one to the Department of the Environment, one to the Department of Jobs, so I'll forward them to you as well.
Perhaps somebody might want to ask either Sean or Ronan a question based on what you've heard from them, or maybe you want to ask each other a question. The purpose of this really is to have your experiences out there and how we can develop that to a point where Mick's come from being unemployed a number of years ago to running a very successful business. Some of you are just starting here. Karen's got her first order from Singapore. So the globe really is your operation. David's on the meat business and moving into other areas as he sees one being complementary to the other. So let's have a little conversation for a number of minutes about this. Who's first? I won't ask Bernard to sing the Gutterman song again. You ask whatever you want to say.
Can I maybe just jump in just to explain a bit more about, I know David, you mentioned the issue of the finance. We obviously experienced delays in getting a merchant ID for adverts.ie. It's just really to make people aware now that, I don't know if you're aware, that Stripe launched in Ireland last week, or actually earlier this week on Tuesday. It's great to have another competitor in the payments market. Stripe, for those who aren't familiar with it, will allow you to accept online payments without the need for a merchant ID at all, and without merchants having to move away from your website. From Advert's point of view, this is really a game changer for us. We'll now be able to offer retailers a one-click purchase option, so they'll be able to sell directly to users without Advert's ever having to touch cash. And without ever having to leave the Advert's website. So it's just really to make people aware that this is out there. If you're running into the problems that we ran into, there's a great alternative now available.
Joan, you actually got a lot of assistance through the Facebook end of things by being able to talk to people.
Yes, we found that very helpful because we didn't have any formal technical knowledge. And Brian was able to go on Facebook and just say something just at the very beginning. He might just even make a comment about what his challenge was for that day. And people in the group came back to him, as well as the team from Google, Facebook and PayPal. There was like a big team of people there, and they sort of sent the message around or the problem around amongst even the team, and someone would come back, or else they might give you a contact name. That was also very, very helpful, because really we felt quite at sea in the beginning, and just to have people you can trust directing you was a great help. I suppose for us now the challenge is now that you're on, to make sure you stay there and that people know about you. And I suppose maybe I take any advice on that. Now, on the course, okay, we did get some Google advice, but it seems like a long time ago now. Even though it's only a few months.
If I could just echo that, actually, because I was on the same program with Joan, and so often when you get that information or when you meet the relevant people, it can be a few steps down the line when you actually really need to apply that information. So in the last couple of weeks, I've really needed to go back on a lot of that information. And rather than just going back over my notes that I wrote down throughout those different sessions, I'm literally able to handpick presentations, go back over Google Analytics, PayPal presentations on fraud, on security, and I can just print them all off, and they're all there. So I mean, it's so easy to do that, to just compile whether it's a Facebook group or whether it's a website that have all these documents there, that are just there and available for any company that's gone through this process. It really helps.
Gordon, is there a fraud database available in other countries? Is this an issue that you mentioned as being something that's of importance here?
Yeah, we know that in the UK, for example, there is risk data that's shared for online transactions, and I know from conversations that I've had, conversations with Michael, that fraud management can be a challenge. It's a challenge for us. We protect ourselves using 3D Secure, but it would be great if we could find other mechanisms to to manage or to enable more customers to buy from us. 3D Secure is often seen as a blocker for many customers. And if we could release that and manage fraud in a different way, that would allow more customers to buy from us. And that would be fantastic because it would just open up for more people to experience our service. At the moment, there's no way of sharing information about fraudulent customers that we've had or fraud problems that we've had. And there's no way of checking the transactions coming through through our website on a daily basis with problems that other retailers have had. And it's quite a common problem, and it's quite a common concern amongst people selling online. It would be good to see something in this area.
Okay. David?
I'd love to learn more about courses and other supports, because certainly from building our existing online trade, we felt completely out in an island where you have to learn so quick on, and it would be fantastic to, you know, the courses that you guys were on, you know, I don't know how you found out about them, but I'd love to feel that there was support, because it was really, you're out there on your own. And you're
Karen, I just heard something, you need to radio. Dr. James Robinson just happened to be listening to it, just pure love.
And Karen?
Somebody sent me an email and thought you might like this. So I did, and then I saw it was on the Irish Times as well. It was advertised a couple of Saturdays in a row. So it was really good and well worth doing. Well worth, because listening to all the problems.
They are going to roll it out, aren't they? They're hoping to,
yes,
maybe as an initiative to continue this forward.
Well, our one, if they can get funding, yes.
Oh, yeah, and we were on different ones, of course, but as SMEs, it was really super.
Yes, so, I mean, I think this is one of the things that we hear very often talking to businesses about, how do you take that first step and what are the supports that are available? And, you know, the problems that each business encounter are often very similar to those that have gone before them. So being able to create some sort of sense of community so that businesses can learn from each other is going to be really important. So I think, you know, government has a very important role to play now in stimulating people to take that first step. And I think this voucher scheme will be a very important path for people to take. And I think in order to make it work, taking some of the learnings and making sure that we put structure around it, we put the theory and the documentation, but as well as the community and the support so that businesses can make this journey and get online and get to new custom quickly.
The support is massive, because from being at it, you know, just to have a community where you even, like today, we'll all go home and, you know, I'd love to go to every one of your companies and learn what you're doing and try and learn from it. And, you know, it's a support like that that you want to feel like people are interested in what you're doing.
It's to have one place where you can go. Like, I found out yesterday from the email about that voucher. My first question was, do I have to be a limited company or is it okay to be a sole trader? And why isn't there one place where we can all go and go, okay, this is what we need to do to go online? There isn't that. It's not.
Okay,
not
well,
there.
That's part of the changes that's happening with the local government system, where we're having the local employment, limited employment offices will be situated in each of the local authorities. So somebody going in will have effectively a one-stop shop right up along the line. Now, if you talk about, Sean mentioned here about Enterprise Ireland, for instance, hosting a site on which companies could get involved. Is there a value in sort of having, for want of a better word, smaller cooperatives where people could get together in groups and say, can we, you know, contribute jointly to the setting up of a site or a hosting site or whatever that might help this, rather than having people trying to feel their way through the dark, as you say, as little islands, when there is so much help around, but to coordinate it and make it effective is the real thing. Nick?
Absolutely, as Taoiseach. I mean, for example, I mean, cooperatives, I mean, I think there is actually some move to head towards cooperatives. The biggest problem, for example, we had at the start, I mean, shipping rates into our nearest neighbours, right, into the UK, are very, very high. And especially when you're not doing the volume, when you really need them to be at their cheapest, right, they're the most expensive. So that's always a problem. So if cooperatives were able to get together and band together and say, well, these are the rates we have in here, because we have 1,000 customers, each of those are only doing 5 parcels a week or whatever else it is, but it's 5,000 parcels a week, so they can get the rates. So it's all about banding together to get cheaper rates. That's one thing for us. I mean, from a fraud point of view, absolutely. Again, fraud is a cooperative type system. That's been a big problem for us. So we've had to go and develop our own fraud database. We do a lot of data checking and making absolutely sure that everything is perfect. There's a lot of companies that come to us and say, well, look, I'd love to actually maybe be able to sort of ping messages into you to get some sort of a response to see, but we Whether or not there's data protection issues there, we don't know that. But it could be, it's certainly worth a talk to the Data Protection Commissioner to see if there's something we could do, get together, and you'll stamp out fraud very, very quickly. Because what happens is we catch the fraud, and then they move on to the company next door, and they get caught for €500 because they have to do all the same learnings again. And the other side of it is, I mean, a lot of people talk, I mean, about websites. I think the whole idea of actual going online is sold to people. But the problem is not going online. There's lots of ways to get online, but it's actually staying online is the problem. I talked to Colm Lyons from RealX yesterday, and he told me that 50 businesses a week are actually dropping online payments. Because what happens is they set up because it's a great idea. Everybody tells them they're going to be millionaires overnight. They set up, they get orders in, but they don't know what to do with the orders. The back office systems don't match the website. Lovely fancy website, but they haven't got the infrastructure in place. So it's very, very important to get back to training and the likes of the clicktailing course. And if we come back to it, then to the voucher as well, I think in some ways, right, a voucher of €2,500 to a company is in some ways going into a black hole, that you're actually better off giving it to towards education, similar to the voucher scheme you have for, it's the €5,000 voucher scheme, the innovation voucher that goes to universities. I think that's a better way to do it because it's actually forcing people into education. They know when they come out of those courses exactly what they've got to do rather than getting €2,500 given to Billy down the road to develop a website and it's dead within a couple of weeks.
This is great. Sean, would you come back on the shipping point there that Mick mentioned?
Taoiseach, just 3 points I'd just like to make from what I've heard. Will said, he talked about kind of, you know, his notes and just how easy it is. The internet has made business easy. And just like people create bureaucracy, people make business complex. Business isn't supposed to be complex. Business is supposed to be easy. And the internet has enabled that. And I would advocate to everybody, make your website customer friendly and easy to navigate, because you're competing with a lot of websites. And you're competing with the attention of a sparrow when people are on the internet. You know, and unless you have something to engage them and it's easy to get around it, you know, you won't keep them for very long. I think there is a lot of merit in having an Ireland host website that people can adapt to. Now, whether that's a cooperative approach or whatever, but just hearing you, just the need for more, you know, coordination or engagement with one another. And I just think of what Paddy Cosgrove is doing with the Web Summit. Now, it's in a different space, but a Paddy Cosgrove to set up an Ireland Inc. web retailing summit, you know, I think could be something that's very useful. And I really like the idea of aggregation of logistics, because online retailing, one of your biggest costs is logistics. And there are, you know, hungry people in the logistics business out there, and they will look at it and say, well, rather than dealing with and having to deal with 20 different companies, if I can do this just, you know, with one cooperative, it makes my business so much easier, and it also gets costs out of my business. And I think there's a huge merit in that, Mick.
Well, now I'm going to. You're all busy people, and the first thing I want to say is, this was an innovative conversation here. It's about you, but it's about so many other people out there who want to make a breakthrough. What you've expressed to us here has been your own initiative from your own perspective to get to where you want to be, and you've outlined challenges and difficulties and opportunities because you're all in different spaces. And yet, I sit here as Taoiseach, if you like. Sharon's taking careful notes here because we will follow these through with the government ministers, Minister Rabbit and Minister Bruton and Minister Perry and so on, to make what impact we can. But the best evidence is the experience you've exchanged here. And I think this has been very valuable because it offers hope and encouragement to others out there who are watching and who are listening and who will have news of this from your point of view, so that they'll have the courage to say, well, I know where to go now, or I'm going to find out where I have to go, where it's going to make the difference to me and what I have to do. So I just want to say that it's been a privilege to have this short engagement with you. I want to thank you for taking the time to come in here
from running your businesses. I want to thank Sean and Ronan in particular from two outstanding businesses, and they give so much time free of charge to their country in mentoring and giving advice to people who want to get on their own, as it were. So I wish you the best in your endeavours. We will try to help you in any way that we can here, because you've got an open door to this government in terms of the development of business. This is about jobs. At the end of the day, politics is always about creating a society where young men and young women can have the opportunity to get up in the morning and go to work, prosper in their own localities, contribute to their country, and therefore to our standing internationally. And you are all part of that. And I admire and respect the efforts that you are making and that you've made to date. And I wish you every continued success. Feel free to engage with each other. Feel free to avail of the expertise that is available and that is around. And we will tie all this together for your betterment and for the opportunity to be presented to thousands of businesses out there who can avail of this exciting new adventure that's available to them. So thank you very much indeed. Gur Imacach.